This Headless Professor video is about operant conditioning using positive reinforcement. In this, as so many types of psychological research, we must identify the principal elements. There's the organism, the animal or person that we are studying as our subject. There is the response that that organism makes, the kind of behavior we're studying. And finally, then there is a stimulus, which is a change in the energy of the organism's environment that the organism can perceive. This is the basic formula for behavior that we study in psychology. A stimulus is presented to an organism and that elicits a response. Or sometimes the organism simply acts on its own when it's very active and emits a response. Operant conditioning usually starts with an active organism emitting a response. And the role of the stimulus is a little bit different in operant conditioning compared to classical. In operant conditioning, the key feature is reinforcement. The stimulus occurs after the response, not before. And the stimulus has the role of a reinforcer of that response. It keeps the response going. So the diagram would look something like this. An active organism emits a response. That response somehow leads to the provision of a reinforcing stimulus, and that reinforcing stimulus makes the organism more likely to respond that way in the future. Some reinforcers are primary. In other words, they are unlearned. The organism responds to that particular stimulus without any particular training. It just has to learn the connection between the stimulus and the response. Other kinds of stimuli and reinforcers are learned in the sense that you've got to learn to appreciate the value of these things, such as money. Well, let's take a look at our organism that we're using today. This is Gigi the dinosaur, and she is Godzilla's granddaughter, and that's where we give her her name of Gigi. In this particular example of operant conditioning, the organism is the dinosaur, and we're going to try to get this dinosaur to dance, and when she does, we are going to reinforce her behavior by giving her food. Of course, we've got to find the most appropriate food for dinosaurs, and after watching the movie Godzilla, I know that the favorite food of this kind of dinosaur is a Japanese policeman. So, here's Gigi, and she's going to start dancing for us. And Gigi's just walking around, not doing too much. She's an active dinosaur, and when she starts moving on her hind legs, we're going to give her some reinforcement. Oh, there she goes up a little bit more. There she's going up a little bit more. And look, the reinforcer is here. Ah, yes, there's a happy dinosaur with her favorite meal. Now, if we repeat that several times, giving her the food after she dances a little bit, after a while, she gets the idea. And here she's hungry again, and she starts dancing right away in hopes of getting her favorite reinforcer again. Ah, yes, indeed. Okay. Now, what can lead to extinction? Extinction is a bad word around most dinosaurs, but let me reiterate that extinction does not mean the death of the species of organism that we are studying, but rather the withdrawal of a reinforcer leading to the cessation of the behavior in question. In other words, if we stopped feeding Gigi every time she danced, she might be less likely to dance so much in the future. No dinosaurs were harmed in this particular study.